to interrupt or ask me a question about anything I say at any time, please just stick your arm up and say it within reason. First of all, I'd just like to talk about the Brad Meldow and the Radiohead tunes that we had before. Just talk a little bit about the building blocks of it from a musician's point of view. I mean, when Brad Meldow would have listened to that, I mean, I'm being incredibly presumptuous here, so I'm sort of more talking about how I would have approached it, but it's probably similar to how he would have approached it. He would have enjoyed listening to the tune. He would have liked what it was trying to, or been interested in what it was trying to express. And then he would have had to analyze the basic building blocks of it, which is, it's a song, and most songs in pop music have got different sections, a verse or a chorus. I'm not sure about this one, but it's basically got a couple of main sections. And how you generally transcribe these is that you analyze the harmonic sequence. There's basically a harmonic sequence which goes through the tune, which is how we approach jazz improvisation. Not all jazz improvisation, but a lot of jazz improvisation is approached by having a harmonic sequence, which is a set number of bars with harmony that develops. I think most people probably understand what I'm talking about. If they don't, say something and I'll go to the piano and explain. But I'm going to try and keep the speaking as short as possible so we can play some music. Anyway, he'll take the harmonic sequence, which might repeat three or four times in the Radiohead version, and then he'll use it, he'll write it out for his band, and then they'll play it over and over again. It's called variation form, and Bach used it a lot. It's used in all musics. So one of the reasons the Radiohead version is 4 minutes and the Brad Meldow version is 8 minutes is basically the number of times he goes round and round and round. Which is, he wouldn't have thought of 8 minutes to start with unless his record company said, just play a tune which is 8 minutes long, we've only got 8 minutes left for the album. But I don't think he would have approached it like that. Basically, they would have started playing and it would have unfolded and until it had a natural structure, and then everyone would have felt it was time to play the tune again. Or if they hadn't, all other people hadn't felt it, you probably would have pointed at them and said, it's time to play the tune again at the end. So that's how we approach a lot of jazz. In terms of his concept of what he was doing, he's greatly influenced by, as most pianists are, by Keith Jarrett and Herbie Hancock, who are probably the two most influential architects of jazz piano in the world today. And as musicians, we can hear the structure, and we can hear the history of Brad Meldow's style. It's not style that suddenly appeared out of nowhere. He's not just sort of making it up out of nothing. It's a language. Jazz is a language with precedents, an awful lot of precedents, and the very few great jazz musicians actually can develop, like in any art form, can develop the I don't know what the word is, but you know what I'm saying anyway. So yeah, that's what we hear as musicians. We hear the language of Keith Jarrett, we hear the language of Herbie Hancock, but what we, above all, we hear the emotional language of Brad Meldow, which is what makes music, and his emotions when he's improvising, singing his song, make him sound like himself. So as far as notation, just going, that's what I wanted to say about the Brad Meldow. As far as notation's concerned, he almost certainly would have turned up to his band rehearsal with a piece of paper and with a melody on it and some symbols, which are just symbols for harmony, which is the basic building blocks of music, and the form. So there'd be a number of bars. And you just repeat those bars over and over again. So if it's a four-bar piece, it goes, and it's in 4-4, and it has a certain tempo. It goes 1-2-3-4, 2-2-3-4, 3-2-3-4, 4-2-3-4. Now, I know this is really simple. This is just like putting bricks on top of each other, but this is basically how musicians think. This is the simple stuff that everybody has to understand to start with before. Yeah, that's all we can cope with, yeah. Now, that's I'm just trying to explain a bit about jazz, really, because a lot of people think that jazz musicians just get together and just sort of make it up willy-nilly and on building blocks. And beyond that, well, you've got to have a serious talent, and there's not many people who've got that sort of talent to actually say something of serious depth with the music and develop the language. I think I'm going to hand over to Steve now, because he's got a few things to say.
You can learn all the chords in the world, but unless you understand the language of the music, you won't have any idea of what to do with it. The chords that people learn in music are the alphabet. That's all they are. They aren't the words. The words are putting two chords together, and the sentences are putting four chords together, etc., etc., etc.
I guess we're also sort of thinking about tension and release. The other 50% is unknown, but that kind of gesture, that proportion is very pleasing. So, you know, if an audience has, you know, 2% that they sort of recognise, and 98% you know, see you later. So, I think that happens in all. I mean, jazz is a dialect of music. It's just a dialect, and the more as a player, I play that music, the more into that language I become, and I suppose what I'm trying to say is, I explore the subtleties. You know, that's certainly a part of the process. Just one other thing, I've worked with dancers quite a lot, and I don't know if you've encountered this before, but I was on a dance course many years ago, and a series of experiments were going on. It was fantastic, some of the things. And I just remember one thing, because I was watching the dancer, and it just triggered off a memory, which was we had a blank stage, and we had a dancer walk from stage left to stage right. So, like, they would be, actually, stage left is over here, so we would run it like this. So if you're the main audience, you'd see this and then move across here. And then we had the same dancer walk this way. And we were just concentrating on the walking, and people were just saying that they observed. And it turned out that actually it felt slightly against the grain when the person walked this way, as opposed to, it felt a little bit kind of more harmonious, less tension. And this was kind of attributed to actually the fact that we read in the Western world from left to right. So we're constantly sort of reading like this, and we flip over and we keep doing this. And this kind of, this sort of idea of just like, you know, this one way that feels easy and one way slightly feels slightly harder just occurred to me. Yeah. So I thought I'd throw that in. It's got nothing to do with notation, but. I think there was just one more thing I was going to say, which was, it's just that the actual structure of a lot of jazz standards, you know, there's a body of songs that were written in the 20s, 30s and 40s in America, the American song, and we use a lot of those songs even today, you know, and we're kind of putting our tricks over them, but actually, you know, standards like I Got Rhythm and things like this, you know, are actually quite perennial, and you know, they crop up all the time in different forms. And actually that structure happens to be often always the same, which is A-A-B-A. You know, in other words, you hear a block of eight bars, which is an A section. You hear it again, then you hear something new for eight bars, and then you hear the A again. So that structure, A-A-B-A, crops up time and time again in jazz music, and it actually is kind of it's a bit like you're talking about golden proportions. I think it's something that we like to hear. You know? So, in the context of jazz, that's kind of something that you might hear. In Jonathan's tunes, he throws most of those out the window. Yeah, we're playing most of his tunes today, but I think we're going to play some standards.
Yeah, we'll play some standards.
That's about it.
What I'm going to say is going to be very it's just that all of what Jonathan and Steve have been talking about, jazz is underpinned by rhythm, and rhythm is very, very important in jazz, because we've all heard of a term called swing, and swinging is a feeling, it's when it feels good. You know when somebody's swinging, and you know when somebody's not swinging. But the intention is always to swing.
matches before, we've James played it on a couple of gigs, he's played it on quite a lot more. But basically, before we played them, we got together for about 5 rehearsals to do what's known as note hashing, which is you have to learn the notes. And after you learn the notes, you actually have to learn what goes around the notes. Now, we didn't do a rehearsal today, so me and James were standing outside and I sang him the tunes. Now, by singing him the tunes, he hears the soundscape within which the notes are going to be, because basically, if I write a tune, I've got a concept of what the soundscape would be, what the vibratory space, it's pretty hard to explain, the music is going to exist. And so by singing the tunes to him the way I want to hear them, he knows the world, the musical world, with what we're doing, what we're dealing in. And this is very important, because when you play a note, you can play a note a million different ways, and it can express an awful lot of things. And so, now this is 32-bar sequence, 4-4, the 4-beat star, and it's an AABA, which is what Steve was talking about, so eight bars of one harmonic sequence, 8 bars of the same, 8 bars of
Thank you.
performance is a whole massive world of study itself, without having to do with actually playing music, just the whole thing.
To my bonus monk, who's probably the most important jazz pianist there is. If you know anything about jazz, go and play some bonus monk, because he's the pivotal.